still rocking after all these years.
This is the story of my rock and roll butler.
This is it, the show that started it all. Often imitated, but never equaled. From San Francisco, USA, online since 2004, it's the one and only Rock and Roll Geek Show with the original Rock and Roll Geek, Michael Butler.
Welcome to the Rock and Roll Geek Show. My name is Michael Butler. Thanks a lot for joining me. I really appreciate it. Today is Monday. What is it? Monday, April 18th, 2022, and it is like 9 a.m. when I'm recording this episode. 9 a.m. Can you believe that? This is a bonus Rock and Roll Geek Show. Short episode. Today, I talked to Archie Cruz from the band Santa Cruz. I want to thank my good friend Chiaki Hinohara of the Japanese Metalhead Show and the Metal Movement Podcast. He's the one that lined this up, believe it or not. This is going to be a simulcast between the Rock and Roll Geek Show and Metal Movement Podcast. What's going to happen is I'm recording this, and I believe Chiaki's going to translate it into Japanese for the friends in Japan. And good luck translating this in Japanese, Chiaki, because you know, I talk a mile a minute and interrupt and do my usual bullshit. But Archie was a cool guy, and I think you might like this 30-minute talk. He doesn't mind talking about shit, and he's, to me, that is what rock and roll is all about. He stands behind what he does, whether you agree with what he did or not. He stands behind it. He owns up to it, and he came on and was very honest, and I hope you like it. Here is the Archie Cruz from Santa Cruz interview. By the way, their new album is called Under the Gun. It'll be out later this year, I think in August or something like that. Thank you, Archie, for coming on and being a cool guy. And I hope you like it, friends. I'm going to shut up now and take it away. Hey, Archie, how's it going?
Good, man. How are you?
I'm pretty good. Thanks for doing this. I really appreciate it.
Absolutely, bro. So it's for Japan, right?
Yeah, I'm in San Francisco, and my friend Chiaki does a Japanese podcast. And what he's going to do is he's going to translate this in Japanese for the Japanese audience.
Okay, sick, bro.
All right, that's, you got that? All right. I was at the L.A. show, the whiskey show.
Oh, you were there?
Yeah, I was actually in one of the bands, believe it or not.
Oh, which one?
J.J. Savage.
Oh, you play in his band?
Yeah.
Okay, right on.
All right. So you got a lot of publicity from that. Are you tired of, how do you feel about that?
Well, obviously, you know, it was a shit storm, to say the least.
So, I mean, are you tired of talking about it and stuff?
No, we can talk about it if you want to. I'm like,
well, first off, let's go back to, you got a new band now, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what happened to the last band? I think there was something happened on the Fozzy tour. I'm a little unclear on it. I think I heard Eddie Trunk talking about it a long time ago. What happened? They quit? What happened?
Well, we were on tour with Fozzy, uh-huh, and we just had a falling out with the rest. I had a falling out with the rest of the guys, and there was like a fight on the tour bus. And, you know, it's they basically threw me out of the bus.
And isn't it your band?
It's my band. So
they threw you out of your band on your bus.
Exactly. And that's the whole fucking dilemma.
Where'd you get thrown out? They just pulled the bus over, opened the door and said, get out?
Huh?
Did they just pulled the bus over and said, get out?
What was that?
Can you hear me?
No, they actually physically threw me out of the bus.
Just in the middle of the road, at a truck stop or something?
We were having an off day, and the bus was parked in like a parking lot.
Okay. Huh.
Like a big ass parking lot. But what? It wasn't just the guys. It was that the tour manager of Fozzy was heavily involved in the situation.
Was there something between the Santa Cruz camp and the Fozzy camp?
Well, there was something between me and the tour manager of Fozzy.
Oh, really? What? Can you, you want to talk about it? I mean, can you talk about it?
Well, you know, I can say something. As far as I'm concerned, I don't think there's any reason why I couldn't. So
I'm not interested in creating dirt or digging up dirt. I'm just curious to find out because it's interesting to me.
Well, okay. So basically what happened is that we were an opening band for the tour.
Right.
So I think we, you know, we started killing it for the first show, from the get-go.
Uh-huh.
So I think what happened, Fozzy started seeing us as a threat.
Oh, right.
And the tour manager started doing fucking, you know, nasty ass things to us.
Like maybe not giving you as good of sound or not as much room on the stage or this and that.
Exactly. Huh. And fucking with my in-ears, you know, and cutting our set short, you know, like shit like that.
Yeah, kind of and immature like, shit.
Exactly. And putting our backstage literally to the fucking toilet of the venue.
Well, you guys have a younger crowd, and Fozzy, I don't know what his crowd's like. I can't imagine anybody would even listen to Fozzy.
Fozzy's crowd is pretty much fucking, you know, semi-retarded wrestling fans.
Right, yeah, yeah. I don't know anybody who listens to Fozzy except Eddie Trunk. And, yeah, I mean, exactly. I couldn't tell you a Fozzy tune. I know he claims to have has a gold record for this last album. Well, I don't know. I don't know anything about the guy other than he has a podcast and he's a wrestler.
Well, you know, Chris Jericho, obviously he's a fucking acclaimed wrestler, you know?
Yeah.
But as far as I'm concerned, he's not a real rock star, dude. Yeah, he's
kind of a big muscle guy and
yeah, it's kind of a, like I see Fozzy as his like hobby, like
right.
He's just like fucking having fun and you know trying to be a rocker when he's actually a wrestler. You know,
you guys were going over better, and then you confronted the tour manager, and what was Chris Jericho doing? He was just kind of like not saying anything.
Yeah, he was kind of in the back. I don't know if he was giving instructions to the guy or not, but like, you know, he was not involved. Like he was, that's how the big rollers do it. They have somebody else, uh-huh, you know,
do their dirty work.
Exactly.
Were you guys all sharing a tour bus with Fozzy?
Unfortunately, yes.
Ah, that's the deal. So did Chris Jericho have the back lounge to himself?
Absolutely. He was there sitting fucking door locked.
So you guys were not allowed in the back lounge. You could only stay in the front of the bus or in your bunk.
Absolutely, that 100%.
Yeah, was there alcohol involved or anything? Anybody drunk or?
We did drink, but well, who doesn't?
Yeah,
you know.
How big's the tour manager? Is he like a wrestler too?
No, he's a fucking fat ass, bro.
Oh, he's fat, fat dude. So you could have probably, if it came to blows, did it come to almost blows?
Well, you know, he jumped on me. He's fucking, yeah, fucking 300 pounds. You know, pure human flesh on me, so that was not cool.
so he threw you out of the bus, and your band was kind of like afraid to stand up to him, or did they just, or they agreed with him?
I think they were agreeing to him. I think they were like fucking about to leave the band anyways.
Oh, really?
for one reason or another. Mm-hmm. So they were like fucking, I think they were like plotting behind my back way before it actually happened.
You've had a lot of guys in your band, right?
What?
Have you had a lot of members in Santa Cruz? I don't know that much about the band. I'm sorry that I don't, because I'm kind of older. But I know JJ, our guitar player, fucking loves you, loves you guys. I mean, absolutely fucking loves you guys. And I thought you guys were great too. But anyway, so you've had a lot of members in the band?
Well, it's always been a four-piece. It's
I mean, a lot of changeover in members.
No, the lineup that broke up on the Fozzy tour, that lineup was like solid for over 10 years.
Oh, okay. So that's the band that's the lineup that,
that's kind of classic.
Huh, yeah. You guys have been together 10 years, and why over for 10 years would these guys agree with a tour manager and quit after 10 years? Was it building or something?
I think it was building, but I'm not, it might, you know what? It might be what you said too. They might have been like afraid of his authority and, you know, and, they might've been afraid to stand up to him too. You was know, that, I don't know.
Did you guys have to, I mean, you know what buy-ons are, tour buy-ons, where you got to buy onto a tour.
Yeah.
You guys didn't have to do that on that tour, did you?
That tour was not a buy-on tour. That was actually, they gave us a fair deal because they, at the time we were actually, kind of popping, so yeah. You know, like
you were on the rise.
We added, yeah. So we added some value on the bill.
Yeah, and you guys started going over, and well, I'm sorry to hear that, man. And so, what did you do when you got where? What town was this? In Canada or something like that, or New York?
No, it was in Seattle, Washington.
Seattle. What did you do when you got thrown off the bus? When you got thrown off the bus? I mean, I'm assuming they gave you your suitcase and your guitar, right?
They didn't give it. Yeah. Actually, now that I think of it, they did. We had a fight with my guitar player, with like a physical fight.
Oh man, that sucks. I've been through it, man. I know how it is. It sucks.
It does.
So what did you do?
Well, you know, we got into a fight and, you know, punches were thrown and just, the rest of the guys, they backed him up and they jumped on me and the fucking fatso came from the back lounge and jumped.
I mean, did they give you your clothes, your suitcase, and your guitar?
Well, they made me sit in the curb for like 2 hours, and then they threw like my fucking stuff out of the bus, and you know, but I have to give it to my bass player and my drummer. They walked with me to the hotel and like had me check into the next hotel, and I spent the night there, and I booked the next flight to New York next morning. And I flew to New York, and yeah, and in New York, I spent 2 days in New York. Then I was trying to text Jericho and shit. I was trying to see if we could carry on with the tour, but that at that point was impossible anymore. So I flew back to Finland, and you know, we started. There was a whole shit show going on, like fucking on social media, on everywhere, and I decided just to carry on with the Santa Cruz name, and I put a new lineup together. We did a whole ass record, and we toured. Actually, we did a U.S. tour with another lineup in 2019 with bands Whitechapel and Atreyu, and we did at with that lineup. We did festivals too, like Aftershock,
right,
Louder Than Life, you know. So it was a success, and then Corona hit. And then that lineup kind of disbanded. And now the current one we have is like just a brand new one.
So were all that lineup that you had, that you did those festivals and stuff, were those guys based in Finland or were they U.S. guys?
We had a U.S. guitar player, but two guys from Finland.
Okay. I think JJ might have actually tried to audition for bass for you guys. I think he told me that. I could be wrong.
Yeah. I remember at the time he was trying to be in the band.
I mean, I don't want to toot that JJ kid's horn, but if something ever happens with you and another guitar player, JJ is a fucking ripping guitar player. I mean, I know you are too. You're like shredder, but JJ is a pretty good shredder too. So you might want to consider him. If anything happens to your new guy, I'm not saying anything's gonna, but you know.
Absolutely, dude.
I'm putting in a word for my boy JJ. All right.
I've seen him do it, and he's great. Now, you know what's crazy? I actually remember bumping into him at NAMM 2015.
Uh-huh.
He was like a really young boy back
yeah,
then.
That's right. Yeah.
But he walked up to me and, yeah, he was like, "Archie, can I take a picture with you?" And he was like super adorable. And you know, seeing him come up from what he was then mm-hmm. to what he is now is pretty sick.
Yeah, he's a real rock and roller. I mean, he slings his guitar low, and he looks cool on stage, and he's got the right attitude too. I mean,
absolutely.
I mean, I would not be sad at all if he broke up his band to join somebody like Santa Cruz. So just putting in a word. Anyway, so where did you find the new band?
Well, Jerry, the guitar player, he's been a fan for years, and he actually told me that it's been his like a lifelong dream to join the band.
Wow.
So he knew all the songs, you know, and shit. And that he's the first guy I hired, and Randy, the drummer, he's his friend. So he, you know, he joined the band next.
So those guys are from LA?
Yeah.
Okay.
And the bass player Tommy, he's from LA too. He's originally from New York, but they just came together quite naturally.
How did it work? Did you guys, I mean, did you say, okay, did you guys record the new album how did it work? Did you send them a set list and say, learn these and send, or did you fly out to LA and meet with the guys?
Well, I recorded a new album last fall by myself. Okay. I recorded myself. Maybe.
You did the drums and everything by yourself?
Yes. Kind of like Dave Grohl with the first Foo Fighters record.
Okay. You did the drums, acoustic drums or electronic drums?
Acoustic, the real drums.
So you play all instruments?
Every single one.
So you did the whole album yourself. So in order to do the song, so have you got, you sent them, just said, hey, here's a set list, learn these and we'll take it from there?
Yeah, that's what I did. But then the other guys, like, they wanted to weigh in to what to play as well. So we like figured out the set list together, like the final set list.
And you were in Finland at this time, and these guys are still in LA.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I came to LA in January to meet up with Jerry. Uh-huh. And we agreed to fucking do it. And I've kind of flew back and forth, you know, in the beginning of the year. And, you know, we put the band together and we start rehearsing and, you know, started chatting. And when I was not in town, the guys were rehearsing by themselves. Yeah. And
that's quite expensive, flying back and forth from Finland to the United States to California.
Well, actually, right now the flights are pretty cheap because of COVID.
Right.
So flying back and forth is pretty much the same as staying in LA, because LA is a fucking expensive fuck.
Yeah, tell me about it. Tell me about it.
Yeah.
Yeah, we stayed at a shitty Motel 6. We're from San Francisco, up, you know, 6 hours north. So we stayed at a crappy Motel 6. I'm sure you stayed somewhere better. I think I saw your pictures. You were with a really good-looking girl and in a nice hotel.
Yeah, that was just for one night. Other days, I stayed in the fucking ghetto.
That's all of Hollywood is a ghetto, pretty much.
Oh, it is. It is, for real.
So you guys rehearsed, and then did you rehearse the week of the show at the Whiskey too?
We did.
You came down for like 2 weeks. You came a couple weeks before the gig and rehearsed.
Yes, sir.
Isn't the drummer from another country too?
He's Mexican. Yes.
Oh, he's Mexican. I thought he was Swedish or something like that.
It looks like he is Scandinavian, but he's fucking Mexican, which is fucking weird.
Mexican, dyed his hair blonde.
Yeah.
He's a good-looking kid, huh?
He looks so good, dude. I wish he played drums as good as well.
Oh, he seemed like a good drummer. Were there drum tracks too?
No, I'm just fucking around. He's a great drummer. the thing that happened at the show was he just didn't play on time with the click, cuz I probably had some problems with the hearing or something.
The old lineup of Santa Cruz, did you guys use tracks?
Just a little bit of tracks. Not much.
I know Fozzy uses tons of tracks.
Bro, they use all fucking tracks, dude. And that's why Eddie Trunk was a piece of fucking shit,
well,
too.
I'm going to tell you something about Eddie Trunk. I think he's a fucking asshole for what he did. I mean, I don't use tracks, and I never have, or I've actually played in a couple of bands that have tried to use tracks. Anyway, what he did to you guys was a fucking shitty thing to do. Let me tell you why. Because you guys are an up-and-coming band. He threw an up-and-coming band under the bus while he is supposedly friends with Motley Crue, who uses more tracks than anybody I've ever heard in my life.
Yeah.
Friends with those guys, never once called those guys out. I mean, Motley Crue, even the fucking bass parts are tracks, okay? He's never called out Blackie Lawless, who I know for a fact uses tracks. I saw them play before opening up for, I don't know, back in the 80s, and the guy took his bass off of his neck, and his bass was still playing. He's never called out his friends in Ghost, who I saw open for Iron Maiden. Lead vocals were going.
Fucking tracks.
Lead vocals were going. He had the microphone down by his waist. He's never called out Fozzy, who's used his tracks. I'm not going to name more. There's probably more that I don't know about.
Bro, every fucking body. And he uses us as an example, like a fucking up-and-coming little band.
Why throw you guys under the bus?
Exactly. For somebody who's bigger, bro, like they can afford it, you know?
I mean, I'm gonna come out and tell you honestly, I don't agree with Trax. I think it's kind of cheating. But to do that to you guys, I think is a shitty thing to do. And it's really fucking, he talks about being all behind up and coming bands and likes to promote new bands. I believe he even named you guys' last album was in his top five albums of that year. So I don't understand why he would do that to a small up and coming band rather than these other people. Who only thing I can assume maybe they won't give him any more interviews or anything.
Yeah, exactly. That's the reason I got so pissed off, because you know I know for a fact that all these bands use Trax, and you know he's not fucking calling anyone else out, so it makes zero sense. To me.
Now, did he reach out and try to talk to you about after I know you guys went back and forth on the social media, which I thought what you did when you said Eddie Trunk, you're a fucking asshole and all this stuff. And I liked it. I was saying I'm starting to like this guy more for standing up for yourself. Did he reach out and try to mend fences or anything?
No, he did not. He did not. Only when I like apologized calling him names like 2 days after, that's when he like fucking settled the score.
How did he settle the score?
He posted my apology on his page and he was like, fucking apology accepted. And he was like, not trying to attack us personally, but like he was just speaking against backing tracks.
Not trying to attack you guys personally. I just posted a link to your video.
Exactly. Fucking.
Did he talk about it on his show? Because I don't have Sirius anymore. I used to have it. I don't have it anymore. Did he talk about it on his show?
I have no fucking clue, dude. I don't listen to him.
Okay, good. It's not. Yeah. He talks about the same shit every time, all the time. He's texting.
Yeah, he's talking about or something irrelevant shit like that.
So, it seems to me, it seems to be kind of difficult to do backing tracks, because especially for the drummer, he's got a lot to do. He's got to work that laptop behind him and all that.
Yeah, it's a lot more difficult than playing live, actually, because when you play live, you don't have to worry about timing. There's no click. You just fucking play it by ear.
So why do it? Why do it then?
Because it sounds amazing if you do it right.
Okay. All right. So now looking back on it, I think I saw you say that maybe you were considering the next show not using tracks.
Well, yeah, because now right now everybody's fucking hating. So the reason we want to just prove everybody wrong and do a kick-ass live show without any tracks, you know.
Well, it's kind of a double-edged sword. On one hand, you got a shit ton of publicity for it.
Dude, exactly. Free. That's what I'm saying. Like, everybody knows the name now.
But now you kind of are under the pressure now that you have to not use tracks, unless you just totally embrace it and do like Britney Spears or something like that. But what do you want to do?
What do I want to do? Yeah. I want to rock! Rock!
Don't we all, friend? Don't we all? Now, what do you do? You know what I'm asking you, though.
Well, personally, I would like to provide my fans and the crowd who come to the show with the best possible experience we can, which would include some tracks. But right now, we were talking with the guys the other day, and we're trying to get everybody to sing, and we're trying to get into a position where we won't have to use tracks.
At this point, I think that's probably a good idea.
I think so too.
I mean, you guys, both of you guys, guitar players, are amazing guitar players.
Thank you.
Did you have any guitar tracks in those intro? Were there any guitar tracks?
No, nada.
Because I would think, I was thinking, you know, if these guys are using tracks, why not have a rhythm guitar? Because when it was guitar solos, you know, there was no rhythm guitar going. It was just a bass and the dual guitar solos. I'm thinking, why didn't these guys, maybe they should have done backing rhythm guitar tracks too. I mean, if you're going to do it.
Well, that's in my opinion, the backing vocals are only the only part where they're allowed.
So it was all, there were no kick drum backing tracks?
No, it was a fucking, Randy had a trigger. He had a big ass trigger.
What does that mean? What is it? That trigger's a double kick or?
Yeah, trigger means you put it on the drum head and it.
Right. And it plays it, a sample. It plays a sample.
Yeah.
What kind of sample did it play? Did it play a double kick or?
No. It's just whatever he played, it just makes it sound fucking.
Okay. You get enhanced the sound. Right. Got it. Okay.
Yes.
So there are no other tracks except for three layers of vocal tracks or whatever.
Pretty much.
Yeah. There were a lot of there were a lot of girls at that show. I mean, like 80 Sunset Strip looking girls, cute girls.
Yeah, bro. That's what we do. That's what Santa Cruz brings.
Well, kudos for that, man.
Oh, yeah.
So where did you do after the show? I saw you get into a nice car and drive away and with your stuff.
Yeah. I actually, we had to shoot a music video the next day, so I just bailed early, got a nice fucking sleep, and went to the desert the next day to shoot a video.
You went to Joshua Tree. Was that for the single?
Yeah, Under the Gun.
Okay. My friend is working, doing radio promo in the United States for that. And,
okay. So, Tim.
Tim Binder. Yes. Yeah, so you know him?
Yeah. He's a great guy.
He's a really cool guy. And Marco, M Theory Audio, the guy's name is Marco, yeah, who owns the label, right?
Yeah.
He used to work at Century Media. He might have been the main guy at Century Media. He signed an old band that I was on this old band on Liquor and Poker Records, which was a subsidiary. Anyway, I'm digressing. So
yeah.
Has the you think anything has gone bad about the band? I mean, you think you've lost some fans or maybe gained fans? What do you think?
No, what I think right now, we have a golden opportunity to actually get bigger, because right now we have to platform. Like, we have the fucking attention of the rock world. And if we do a kick-ass show next time around, I think this, all the publicity we got from this will turn out to be good.
When is the next show?
It's going to be August 25th at the Whiskey, back at the Crime Scene.
Oh, really? Huh.
Yeah.
Well, maybe I'll have to go out. Maybe J.J. Savage will be on the bill. Who knows?
Absolutely.
So the Whiskey, you know, they're well known for their pay-to-play bullshit. You know that, right?
Yeah.
Did Santa Cruz, you didn't have to pay to play that gig, did you?
No, we actually got cold hard cash to play there. So.
Very nice, very nice. So all the other bands paid you guys to play.
Yeah.
Is there pay to play in Finland?
No. Yeah. No, we don't have that shit here.
Actually, you guys get paid by the government, don't you?
Yes.
It happens in all of Scandinavia, I think. Sweden and there's Michael Monroe in Finland. Do you like Michael Monroe?
Yeah, he's great. He's a fucking legend.
He's legendary, yeah. What other big Finland bands are there?
Him.
H.I.M., that's right. I forgot he's from Finland. He's got a new thing starting up.
Yeah, he's just doing a solo tour. He's coming to the U.S. And we had the power metal band called Stratovarius in the 90s.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
And Children of Bodom.
Children of Bodom, which you guys are affiliated with Children of Bodom, aren't you?
Yes. Alexi was like my fucking guy when he was alive.
Okay, yeah. Didn't one of the guys in Santa Cruz go with, is he worked with some of those guys? Or one of the guys, I don't know. I'm just hearing from JJ about the, what's that?
We had like a local band. We had a cover band with him, like a hobby.
Yeah,
like
the local band where you did that, Veronica's cover.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. And there's fucking 69 Ice is from Finland.
Oh, okay. They're big. They're kind of
Yeah.
I get Finland sometimes confused with Sweden. There's tons of Sweden bands. And you like any, what are some of the bands you listen to?
Fucking from Swedish bands, Europe, Yngwie Malmsteen. What else? Fucking Amon Amarth, the Viking metal band, Bathory.
Oh, you like that kind of music. You're into that music. What about bands like Backyard Babies, Helicopters, those kind of bands?
Oh, they're absolutely fucking, Yeah, I had a must have had a brain freeze not to mention those bands, but they're fucking great bands. Backyard Babies was awesome.
Yeah, Dragon's a legend and over there, huh?
Absolutely.
What are your favorite guitar players?
My favorite guitar players, Yngwie in his prime, Eddie Van Halen, Jason Becker, Richie Kotzen, Zakk Wylde, mm-hmm. Slash. And right now, from like the young people that are currently in the scene, I would say Jeff Loom is from Arch Enemy, and Brandon Ellis from about Black Dahlia Murder, and fucking Richie Faulkner from Judas Priest.
Okay, yeah, okay, there you go. All right, well, Archie, is there anything else you'd like to say before we get out of here?
Fucking rock on, and.
I hope I didn't make you feel uncomfortable asking the stuff questions about backing tracks. Have you done any other interviews since this thing happened?
Yeah, I did one for a Finnish magazine, like a big magazine, and I did one for a podcast in Las Vegas.
What was that podcast called?
I don't remember, but it was pretty cool.
Okay, they were nice to you.
They were super nice.
Okay, well, that's good. Some of these other podcasters can be dicks.
Yeah, you just gotta fucking if they're gonna go that way, you just gotta fucking out talk them, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Has anybody got in your face and said, "Motherfucker, what you did was wrong," and I'm gonna anything like that?
No, just social media, bro.
Yeah,
I don't.
You seem like live. You seem like you could take care of yourself in a street fight.
Absolutely, bro. I'm into martial arts.
Oh, really? What are you? Are you a black belt or a brown belt, green belt?
No belts. I just have a sensei.
Okay.
Who's got all that? But I can Jean-Claude Van Damme your ass any day. So.
Well, I don't want to fight you, so don't Jean-Claude Van Damme my ass. I'm too old.
No, I won't do that to you. But if you want to come at me, this is just a public challenge to anybody.
I want to come out and tell you, I don't think you should have apologized to Eddie Trunk.
Well, you know, I didn't think so either, but, you know, it's 2022, and if you call somebody fat ass, they literally can cancel your career, yeah. So.
You know, it kind of made you more like Guns N' Roses. You added the danger, you know, get in the ring, motherfucker, that kind of shit.
Exactly, bro. That's what I grew up on, dude, fucking. Wallace Duran, suck my fucking dick.
I don't think Axl would apologize to Eddie Trunk.
No, bro. Axl would have fucking kicked his ass.
Yeah, so you should not apologize. You should kick his ass too.
Absolutely.
I'll be 10 feet behind you, egging you on, okay? All right, Archie, I appreciate you coming on and doing this, man. You seem like a cool guy, and I hope the next show you don't use backing tracks and you teach that bass player how to sing a little bit.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And you kick ass because both of you guys are shredding guitar players. I don't know how good of a bass player that kid is, but I know both of you guys are really ripping guitar players, and I think you don't need backing tracks, to be honest with you.
Well, next show we're probably gonna not use them, so
I'll bet you the next show at the Whiskey's packed.
Hell yeah, it will be packed for sure.
I mean, this last one was pretty well attended. For a Wednesday night, it was real well attended.
Yeah, it was. It was. I believe it was almost sold out.
Yeah, it was a good crowd. And no, and in defense of you guys, I don't think anybody there, I mean, everybody there, I probably knew you were using backing tracks. I knew. Nobody there seemed to give a shit.
No, they were having a straight up good time.
But now everybody there is going to be going, I want to see if they're doing the tracks. I want to see if I can catch the tracks. Now everybody's there thinking backing tracks.
Exactly. So we got to fucking prove them wrong. You know, that's the move right now. We're like under the scope right now.
Now, when is the show again? To give the date again?
August 25th.
August 25th. When is the album coming out?
It should be out in August as well, but that's not locked on yet. So.
Okay. Well, I hope when the album comes out, hopefully you'll come on and we'll talk about the album and not talk about backing tracks.
Absolutely.
And
will be my plan.
What do you have to, have you been to Japan before, the band?
Many times, bro. This is why I'm stoked to do this, because like fucking, I'm trying to go back out there. I played there 3 times, and I've been there on a holiday 4 times. So I really love the country.
So do you have a message for the people of Japan? Not rock on. Don't say rock on.
I love Japan. I love you guys. I love Japanese fans. And I'm looking forward to really coming back to your beautiful country and playing a show for you guys.
Everything's still good with the other guys in the band? Any thoughts of replacing any of the guys?
There's been some discussions, but we're a gang. We stay together. We stay solid. And we're going to do this together.
Okay. If there's any, again, Archie, if there's any problems with that guitar player, call JJ Savage. He's your man.
Will do. Thank you.
All right, Archie. You want to plug the social media or anything?
Yeah. Just fucking hit up Archie Cruz on Instagram, Santa Cruz Man Official, and SantaCruzManOfficial.com.
All right, Archie. I wish you the best, my friend, and thank you again for doing this. I really appreciate it.
Absolutely, bro. Talk to you soon.
All right. Talk to you later.
All right. Bye, man.
Bye. There you go. Archie Cruz. Seemed like a cool kid. I'm sorry. I stand behind this guy. I don't agree with backing tracks, but I think Eddie Trunk was kind of a dick for doing what he did. Let's see. Do I have any Santa Cruz on here? Let's see here. Let's see Santa Cruz. I want to close out with a song. So, oh, look at here. I got Bad Blood Rising. I got the entire fucking album. I got Bad Blood Rising and I got Under the Gun single. Let's play River Phoenix, okay? Thank you for listening, friends. Rockandrollgeek.com. Chiaki, thank you for doing this. Chiaki lined this up. Metal Moment Podcast and the Japanese Metalhead Show. People in Japan, thank you for tuning in to this Rock and Roll Geek Japanese crossover show. I love Japan too, man. I can't wait to get back to Japan. And I love my friend Chiaki. Thank you, Chiaki, for lining this up. Here is Santa Cruz, River Phoenix. We'll talk to you soon, friends. Let's go.
Phoenix.
It's a rock and roll geek train wreck.